All right, so check this out. This is a problem. This is why I got called. Wow, there's a nice big crack right in there. Yeah, that is definitely not repairable and definitely a problem. So this is really pretty much from age. I think this is actually a fairly decent constructed tub, but it's just, you know, it's 23 years old, so it can get brittle over time. And yeah, I guess somebody fell and put their knee through it. So that's why we got called in. All right, so this is a pain point for a lot of families, especially when an old tub surround cracks, leaks, or has any type of problem. This is something that the family obviously depends on. So I'm gonna go in this video, go over a whole bunch of tips that's gonna help you and prevent you from getting overwhelmed with a process like this, and be able to easily, so you know exactly what to do and what kind of tools you're gonna need to be able to do to replace this. So definitely pay attention to each one of these. Each one of these has been kind of, you know, my own personal experience about how to handle going about this. Now, granted, every plumbing situation is gonna be a little bit different, but I got you covered there. If you wanna join one of my courses, I'll have guides, checklists, and a bunch of different scenarios to reference you to on moving plumbing or changing things out. But this one is particularly just gonna be changing out an existing tub and putting in a new four-piece acrylic tub surround. All right, so the first tip is measuring. You wanna order everything in advance, especially if you're getting something, you know, special order of any sort. So going through the measurements to make sure that you can try to fit this in the space so that you don't have to do any more additional work than is necessary. So first thing is just to get the width. Now, this is gonna be different on every situation as far as the wall thickness, but right now I'm reading 58 inches, and that's pretty common. So that means that I have a 60 inch wide tub and that this is kind of buffered out a bit, and that's what's creating that 58. So there's really two common size tubs that are really been made even 20 years ago and kind of common through the industry, and that's a 54 inch tub, a 4'6", which that's not really that common, but they still do make tubs that size. And then they have a tub that's 60 inches, and nowadays you're getting them into bigger tubs like 66, 72, you know, you're getting some pretty large showers. But the most common is a 60 inch. This is a 60 inch wide tub. Now, as far as depth goes, this is the other measurement you wanna make. And we're reading 31.5 inches. That means that we have a 32 inch tub surround, or a 32 inch tub. So in this particular situation, I ordered a tub that was 32 by 60, and then the tub surround kit fits that standard 60 inch tub surround. Now, the other thing you wanna pay attention to is the fact that a flange is gonna come outside of this area. So on all the way around this entire tub surround, there's gonna be a flange that comes around. So, you know, you're gonna have to do some drywall work one way or the other when you replace something like this, or you can do tile. Tile's not a bad idea. That's actually a really good idea if you just wanted to do some tile around the top of the surround. But you're gonna have some drywall work regardless because this flange comes out. So that's what we're gonna have to cut out first thing so that we can get this tub surround out. And this is a one piece tub surround. This was set in place before they framed in the bathroom. So this has to be torn out in pieces, and then you're gonna have to get a different style of tub, which is gonna be a four piece tub. It's gonna have the tub and then three wall panels to be able to do this and get it in this doorway. Okay, so I'm just gonna take my level. This is kind of like what I normally do, because that flange is gonna come up about an inch, but I'm just gonna cut out this entire width, which is, I think it's like 2 inches or 2.5 inches. About 2.25 inches. So 2.25 inch strip. This just makes it easy because I can get a nice straight line right against here. Okay, so we're gonna take our faucet off here before we cut anything. So then the tub spout is gonna be kind of the same thing, and some of them are gonna have Allen keys. Some of them you can just thread out like this one. So this one just has a male adapter that's attached. I'm gonna take our drain assembly apart here. Okay, so this is a tub wrench. All right, so if there's one tool that I think every homeowner should own, because it's so universal and you can use these for so many things, is this oscillating tool. So this is really helpful to cut out drywall, even cut up this tub surround if you wanted to. And what I think is great about it is that you have a lot of control with it. Sawzalls, you know, they work great if you're careful with them, but if you stick them too far into the wall, you can cut wires, you can cut plumbing. So having something like this is just very universal. You can cut your plumbing with this, and cut, you know, obviously the drywall. And you'll find that, you know, when you're putting in trim or flooring, I mean, it's just endless what this little tool can do. So it's definitely a lot more universal and easy, user-friendly compared to a sawzall. Cut this out. I am going to use a sawzall. Now you could use that oscillating tool to do this as well. It's just going to take a little bit more time. But if you do a sawzall, try not to get too long of a blade. And then don't go all the way into the cavity. You want to be basically just getting it through the fiberglass, because you never know. This is a great place for electricians to run wires around. And in some circumstances, even the plumbing is kind of run around that area. Let's first get all the drywall off of around here. Okay, so you can even see here now once I measure it, 59 and a half. Woo. But there is 60 between these joists, so this must be just this board here that's sticking out a little bit. So we're gonna have to do something with that. That's definitely, there's movement in there. So it's just that stud kind of pushing out a little bit. But main important thing is stud to stud, 60 inches. Yeah. Now I do notice one thing right off the bat, that this looks really unlevel to me. Holy cow. That is like, what is that, an inch? Inch and a half? My goodness. It's inch and a quarter anyways. Holy cow. Why is that far off level? Wow. We're okay this way. Holy cow. Well, we are going to be setting this in a mortar bed, so let's get some of this cement board out of here. So I don't know why they have half inch drywall in there, but really my tub to this wall is 31 3/4. Now I could cut the tile a little bit, or I can get rid of this extra piece of drywall, which is a little unusual. I'm not sure why they exactly have it. So I'm gonna take off this drywall. All right, so this is our P-trap. You can see it's down below the joist here. So we're just gonna cut this completely off and put a whole new drain assembly. We're gonna put a new drain assembly on the tub, but we'll just put a new P-trap as well. I never really did care for these type of slip nuts. Let's take that out of there. Okay, so if you're getting a new tub in and you're trying to keep the old pipe here, it's gonna be very difficult to get this tub into place with this sticking on here. So we're just gonna twist this and move this out of the way, so that's not in the way of, now you're not gonna all have threaded pipes like this, but you wanna just get this out of the way so that I can slip the new tub in. If this is soldered, you're gonna have to cut the pipe and re-solder it, because it's really pretty much really difficult to get the tub in an alcove like this with that port sticking out like that. Somewhere around 32 inches, 34 inches here. And then if they can get a 30 inch bar, so that would be anchor into this wood block and then somewhere over here. So just give them plenty of options to be able to either put a 24 or a 30 inch grab bar. Okay, so I'm gonna put some tar paper down so that we can put mortar over this. All right, we're gonna go ahead and dry fit this. That don't really slide, does it?
What's it getting caught on?
It's getting caught on this stud here. All right, so tubs are really difficult to get in an alcove like this when you have a finished wall on either side. So my recommendation is to actually cut out the stud at the tub level next to, hopefully on an interior wall. Most of the time you have one exterior wall and one interior wall to work with. So cut the interior wall so that you can slide this into place. So let's go ahead and cut that. Now it all depends on the size opening you have. Sometimes you have, you know, a 61 inch opening and you can just fit this right in, but this one's exactly 5 foot. So like there's really no wiggle room. So the next best thing is just to cut this stud. What I'm gonna do is just cut this. This is an interior wall, obviously, this is the closet. So I'm gonna cut this stud out and just pull this whole part out, and then we'll just reinforce it after we get the tub in. You can see this is kind of going into the wall cavity now. And so now I should be able to, it's just sitting in.
No,
finally. Well, it's not all the way in. It wants to sit in a little bit more. that's where it wants to sit. Except for so this guy will have to be, the mortar's gonna have to hold this whole side up. I'm lifting it up a little bit, yeah. But the, I mean, it's just, it's yeah.
Worse, or what do you
no, think? It'll be probably a little bit better. All right, so once you have this established where you need it, as far as level goes, let's go ahead and mark. That's pretty level there. Let's mark our studs because we need to get a ledger board on here. So we're gonna have to dry fit it again with the ledger board. And measure down for where that needs to be. This is all a little bit uneven all the way across. You just have to do your best to gauge it. But it looks like we got 1¼. Yeah, 1¼. So that's what we need to measure down and set our ledger board. Mother, I am not. I think it's when I lifted, put it in the truck this morning, or when I put it into the truck. Okay, so we're gonna be 1¼. Just needs to be lifted up a little bit with the mortar. What does this look like? Not terrible. Yeah, I mean, when I tuck that there, that's good there. It's just this front left corner. That's what we'll do. And that's not too bad. You can caulk that nicely there. So, what does this look like? It's good. Okay, so one of the reasons I like this tub is you can see that it's all fiberglass reinforced. It got these long ledgers that is here to support. So I'll be putting mortar all in between this cavity here. And you know, this just really gives a nice solid foundation to the whole tub. It also has a very thick flange at the bottom here. So you can tighten your drain down here and not worry about anything cracking. But just having the flange and everything really well reinforced is one of the main key reasons that I like using these American Standard studio tubs, or really any of their tubs that I've seen so far, are really awesome. So one way to make this a little bit easier for yourself if you're doing everything yourself is to connect the trap arm on your tub before you go setting it into place, because then you can do the overflow after that's installed. This is always a troublesome thing to do by yourself, but you know, it will make it a little bit easier if you attach that before setting the tub into place. So this is the trap arm here, and this is just a push-up type of drain assembly. Now, one thing you really have to pay attention to here and be careful with is that this is brass, as you can see, and this is plastic. So you really have to make sure that this is threaded on well, because it's very easy to cross-thread, and once you cross-thread it, it's pretty much done. So make sure you have your gaskets. It'll come with a gasket for the bottom of the tub. And I'm gonna silicone this all together to make sure that it's a good seal. So 100% silicone. We're using the GE Advanced Kitchen and Bath. So just put a generous amount right on this flange of the tub. Don't worry about the excess. We'll be able to wipe all that off. And like really more the better, honestly. Okay, and then for the actual tub adapter here, put a little bit of silicone around that. Okay, so you can see that all oozing out of there. That's a good sign. I'll be reaching in here and using my little tub drain to help screw this in. So I would recommend putting a little bit of silicone right on the bottom of the tub. Get your rubber gasket on there. And then I like to do a little bit on this receiver as well. So it's a little bit redundant with the silicone, but it really makes sure that it's well sealed. And then this part is where you have to be careful. Just make sure that you don't cross thread this thing. So make sure that that's spinning. And you're, as long as you can do that, you're in good shape.
Yay.
And we'll just take our tub drain. So one thing you want to pay attention to here is make sure that your rubber gasket is even around this tub drain, because if you over tighten it, it likes to squeeze this out. So just make sure that you push this in and make sure that's all nice and even around that tub drain. Now I am going to have this a little bit offset just because of the way my plumbing, or my joist I should say, is working out. I need to move this. So don't be afraid to keep this at an angle if you have to. You can always get an elbow or something on your overflow. Obviously you just don't want to be notching too much of your joist. Okay, then all that excess silicone you can just wipe out of here. Fiberglass, nasty stuff.
Oh, is it like a hair?
Yeah. Should be wearing gloves with this.
Oh, like one of those.
It's better. Yeah, this fiberglass is nasty stuff. Definitely try to wear some gloves with this stuff. All right, so we're gonna be using a 4-to-1 sand mix for the mortar bed. Now you could use any type of mortar. You just wanna make sure it doesn't have any aggregate in it. Anything with little stones or pebbles in it is gonna make it really difficult to level out. So make sure you just get like a regular type of mortar, and usually one bag will do it. We're gonna make this a little bit thick. Okay, so this is like a thick consistency that you would be kind of laying brick with. So, you know, if this was a completely level subfloor, you can make it as loose as you want. It's just gonna kind of make it so that it has a little bit of support underneath of it. So let's go ahead and spread this. Put this down right down the middle. Okay, so we'll leave it a little thick so then we can kind of push it into place where we need it, but basically it's just going to basically support the belly of the tub. Another thing it's nice to do is put a little bit of silicone on your ledger board. This will help keep any squeaking from happening, or also will adhere it to it. Now we just want to set this into place where we're not completely compressing the mortar. Okay, so pay attention to your marker lines over here, and we'll, the mortar is holding it up, so that's good. Pre-drill our corner. And we want to use some galvanized screws. Okay. good there. That's nice and level. Tub is in. All right, so drain assembly, pretty simple. Just make sure that the wedge part of this gasket slides into your drain. So nothing much more different than any normal P-trap. And then we'll connect into our drain. Now, this does have a real rubber gasket. You wanna make sure that you set, and now it is beveled too. So the shorter part goes down at the bottom. The fatter end is at the top. So make sure that that, it's just as important to have your sealing of the overflow as it is the main drain, because anytime that anything overflows, you have a problem. So now I'm going to use a whole bunch of silicone on this as well, on this and the back of the tub, and this just is going to ensure that I have a good seal. Has a little gasket here. Just want to make sure that that's on there. Still need to be more than an 8-inch piece on that. Good. All right, let that sit up for a few minutes. Go adjust that piping upstairs and we'll test it out. Okay, so this tub does sit up higher than it used to. So I'm gonna have to cut some of this down in order to make this work. So we're gonna just basically cut this and put a coupling up so that this can sit up higher. Okay, so just want to make sure that you hear it overflowing. Just check to see if there's any leaks from your overflow, and then just release all the water. Make sure we don't have any leaks anywhere. All right, so with the water running down, just make sure that everything around the tub spout or the tub drain is good. There's no water, everything's draining functionally, so good to go. All right, well, we got a tub surrounding temporarily here. The tub I was happy with, it was just obviously troublesome with the unsquareness of all these walls and then how unlevel the floor was. But that's all part of remodeling. It's always a challenge. But I'm really, really disappointed with what American Standard made here for tub surround kit. It's just an absolute flimsy piece of crap. I'm not going to install this. It's just going to be temporary until I order something better. Because this is just not going to last. I mean, even if I did have more support in between here, I mean, it's just, there's nothing to it. It's really, they shouldn't even make anything like this. So, but the tub is great. I've always had a good rapport with the studio tubs, really well reinforced. Why they would make a tub surround like this, I have no idea. But we're going to order something better and then we'll get everything wrapped up. All right, lesson learned. You really have to pay attention to what you're buying these days. Just because it has a name brand on it doesn't mean it's really any good. And I'm really disappointed with this one because I've always been touting and saying that American Standard is like, you know, exactly that. That is like a really great product. But they came out with a tub surround that is just, I can't install it. It's too flimsy. Now granted, I don't have this fastened in place, but it's like literally, I don't even know how mil thickness that is. It's just absolute garbage. I could just see this not lasting a very long time. I accidentally cracked it when I got it out of the truck because, you know, you basically just dropped the box and it broke. So we're going to install a different surround that I think is much better constructed. So just know that you can't just rely on what the name brand is or even how much money you spent. I spent $600 on this tub surround and it's... it's deplorable. So we're going to remove this. We're going to put in one that's a better constructed. But from my experience now, it's basically American Standard tubs are still really great quality. I was very, very happy with this with a mortar set. Very well made. And I've installed dozens of these types of tubs and have been really happy with it. But the tub surround is no good. And then on the reverse end, I'll show you what we're going to be doing. We're going to be installing a Delta surround. Now, the Delta tubs are garbage, but the tub surround is actually pretty good. So let me show you what the other one is and how much better constructed it is. So you can just see, it's like, there's really no stability to it. And you can see how this whole panel was flat. There's nothing from keeping this like bending back and forth. Like there's really no reinforcement. And that's one of my biggest complaints about it. You'll see my other tub surround that it actually has, it's rigid on its own. It might not be thicker than this, but it just has better support. So this whole smooth area here, that's all flimsy, it's just always going to look terrible, and it's always going to move on you. Every time you press it, you're going to feel it kind of move a little bit. So this one is a Delta 500 series, and you can already see that it has some nice ridges support, and the shelves are a lot better constructed. It even has this little bar up here. This kind of gives it rigidity, so there isn't really... Even on its own, without being glued in or anything, it's pretty rigid. So let me show you back here real quick. So in the back, yeah, you can see how just having these little bends here gives it a lot more superior sturdiness. So it's being curved out like that, like this is all solid. And I'd have to say this is probably twice as thick as the American Standard. So definitely a lot better. Now, all of these direct-to-stud type of tub surrounds, you need to have blocking kind of like everywhere, especially where it specifies. So make sure that you have the blocking specified. We have, this is, now I have ductwork here, so I can't really do anything about that. But you would have two blocks here at 48 inches in between the studs right in the middle, and that just gives it more rigidity on the back wall. We also put some supports here for a grab bar. So pay attention to, if you plan on putting a grab bar in, you definitely want to get some blocking behind the area that you're going to be doing that. Then obviously you want to have all your corners, make sure that they're completely blocked. And then you just want to be about 13 1/4 inches from the wall stud to your first joist. And then everything else can be 16 inches on center. We also have blocks for the sides. These are supports for if I wanted to put shower doors on here. So this is protruding out of the tub surround. We'll show you that here in a minute when we install the side panels. But this essentially allows you to put shower doors onto this. We got blocking here for underneath of our shower faucet. Again, you want to have blocks here. This is helping support things. So support is really important. The other thing with a tub surround that you really want to kind of evaluate before you even get started is how level your wall is or how plumb your wall is. If this is unplumb and moving out that way or this way, it makes it a lot more difficult to get these panels in line, especially the side walls that come in. So you can imagine if this was coming in this way, you're basically your panel is going to meet down here before it meets in the corner, and then you're gonna have all types of problems. So everything has to be plumb. And so with these tub surrounds, if I was a quarter inch out per se, I would shim everything out to level. And then even if I had to come over a bit onto my tub surround or my tub deck, I should say, I would be totally happy with that. Being plumb is more important than how much more reveal you have around your actual tub. Now, this is designed to be installed with a Delta tub, but I highly recommend you don't buy a Delta tub. I had some serious issues with some, especially around the flange of the tub cracking. So I really just advise against it. The American Standard tub is much better constructed. So unfortunately, that's where we are these days. You have to kind of pick and choose what parts of the brand are good. And I'd still say that the American Standard tubs are really great. It's just the tub surrounds that are kind of lacking in space. So let's get this prepared for this 500 Delta series tub surround. Okay, so this has a big cavity here. So if you ever wanted to put shower doors in, you're gonna need blocking to be able to support your shower doors. So we're gonna make sure that we have that prepared. We're not putting on shower doors, but we're just gonna make sure that we're prepared in case they do wanna eventually do that. So you basically need to be 2 inches off the tub. And 2 inches outside of the stud. And this needs to extend out. Okay, so now you have blocking behind there when we install this. Everything's nice and tight to the base. And we got areas to screw into our surround. Now, the one other thing you need is a block at the top here. So then one thing we have to do is this is going to be like right in the middle of this tub surround in a very bad spot, basically right at this curve. So we're going to have to raise this up. So let's go ahead and just really make it like a normal height these days. Like this is probably 70, 74. Wow. That is really low. I would at least bring it up to 80 inches. Just give yourself plenty of room, especially with all the shower heads. But that is an extremely low shower head, and that's not ideal. So we're gonna go ahead and coupling this up. And so let's get a support in here for our shower head. Okay, so we're just gonna cut this in a random spot. Just raise this up to a normal height. But just wipe the excess off after you get a whole bunch on here. So we're gonna have to get a block here too at 50 3/8. Okay, it's just got a little notch in here so that we can get this in where we need it. So off of the floor, you wanna have another block 48 inches across the back. Now I do have ductwork here, so I'm obviously not gonna be able to put anything there, but we'll at least get a block right here in the middle. But if you didn't have this, you would want to put another block right in the center here. You might have to modify a couple things. So one thing I could tell, so this is kind of getting, it pinches here. So I just want to cut a little bit of this side here, just because of the thickness of this. This flange here is probably thicker than what the delta was. But I just basically just want to, this isn't going to hurt anything with the waterproofing. This is just the slide down below. There, something like that. Yeah, so just as long as this is nice and tight against here. Yeah, see that? It's nice and tight now. So you just want to make sure that this is going to sit tight against that base. Yeah, it's pretty level. So that's the most important thing, is making sure this level, because if this is tilting in or tilting out, it's going to make this panel like so. If this was out for some reason, you're going to want to shim this out. You're going to want to shim that whole stud, because the support is behind those blocks and everything. So if you need to shim it out, you're going to have to shim the whole stud out to make it even. Okay, so the one thing you're going to need to get is some sill gasket. So this stuff, it just helps to pad the studs. So you obviously don't need it this wide. Put this down. I'll just staple that on. You want to keep this up above here at the bottom. We're going to get a couple dabs of glue on this back wall. All right, let me grab my caulking gun. Okay, so this is like a no caulk strip. I really don't like it. It definitely buffs it up too much. And it's definitely more designed for the actual delta tub. So we're just going to use some Quad Max. This is a flexible poly sealant. So this is going to be what we're going to basically caulk and bond this surround in place to the tub surround, or to the tub, I should say. So we're just going to put a generous amount right here at the bottom seam here. One on this bottom part of these two studs here at the bottom on the back. When I put a decent glob of this, so that's going to help secure it to the stud. So we'll be caulking this joint, but any oozing sealant you want to get out of that joint. Side panel. Before we put it in place, that's nice. So this interlocks. So you slide this into place. So let's go get ahead and get some sealant. So you basically slide it up. To where it interlocks. Okay, so we're going to cut off this here, because it's probably not going to be at the right size anyways, so we'll cut this off and put a new one on, because you really want to have this pretty accurately done to your port here, because you really don't want to have excess of cuts around here, because you want to be able to seal around this tub support. So there's no shame in templating something and trying to basically get this right. So I'm just gonna mark this by 3 3/4. So let's just see what that looks like. Okay, so we're gonna just cut a 3-inch hole here. But that's pretty good. So this is the front, and this is gonna be where it meets into it. Okay, so this needs to be moved back, unfortunately. But that's a really nice tight joint around there. I'm happy with that. Slide this guy into the groove in the corner. Seal around this now. It's probably the most critical area where you see water damage. Okay, so since this has needs to be buffered out a little bit, we'll put a piece of plywood here. Okay, so before you put the drywall on, put a little bead of this. All right, so we're gonna use some 45-minute mud, and this is gonna help us tape everything and be able to get a finish coat on today so tomorrow we can paint. So this stuff is exactly what it says, but basically about 40 minutes, it'll harden up and then you can get your second coat of mud on. All right, so caulking. This is the final step to your tub surround. So I want to give you a couple tips on how to go about doing this and make sure that you have a good caulking job that's going to last for years to come. Now, caulking is the one area, unfortunately, is a maintenance issue. Usually every couple of years you have to replace it. But if you get a good bond the first time, it should last a really long time. So I have a bunch of different tools here, and I'll explain to you why I have all these and what I'm using them for. So first thing is to get a really decent quality silicone. So this is made by GE, and it's tub and tile, and it's 100% silicone. So that's really important for anything that you seal. It should be 100% silicone so that it can last a really long time and has the elasticity to hold the joint in. Now, I always have a bunch of different caulking tools on hand. They make them in kits where you can get like 8 or 9 different types. And as you can see on here, it has a whole bunch of different ways to finish the caulking. And then I have these little fake finger types. These things are really flexible. Sometimes they're not always used. It depends on each situation and what size gap you're filling. So unfortunately, I have not found a caulking tool that is universal for absolutely everything. It always depends on the size of the joint, what you're doing. If you're caulking tile, that's a whole different animal as well. So it is, you know, as a contractor, I have a whole bunch of different styles. But one of my favorite is this Anvil caulking tool. It basically has 2 different sizes. As you can see, that's a smaller size there. And then you can switch it around and use the bigger size of the caulking tool. So this one I have found to be fairly close to universal. We're gonna try this one out first because it's usually my favorite one. And then if we don't get the results that we want, we're gonna use this. Now, it is a good idea to have some kind of spray. I actually wanted to try this out. This is called Caulk Ease. Basically, you silicone everything and you spray it down, and it should help resist having smearing of the caulking onto your tub surround. Now, what I've been using for years is just straight up Windex after that. That works well, but I have a feeling that some of these products that are made specifically for this should help and make it a little bit even better in a lot of ways. So the first thing when it comes to caulking is just to make sure you don't cut the tube too much. Now, I already did cut this one, but I always start out with like around 3/16. And as you can see, I have it cut like on a 30 degree angle. You know, depending on how big the gap is, you basically want to have it the same size. And then you're trying to fill the joint without overfilling it. The more that you overfill it, the more likely you're going to get smearing. So you really kind of want to make the perfect amount of silicone for every joint that you're doing. Now, if you have some really big joints in combination with small joints, it might be just best to buy 2 tubes of caulking. Because once you cut it too big, then you really can't use it for anything else. And again, it's about having the minimal amount, or you know, the maximum amount of silicone to hold the joint in, but the minimum amount so that you don't have it smearing all over the tub. So we're going to go ahead and do our bottom seam here first. And the main reason I'm doing that is because when I spray this, I'll be able to smear it. But then, like, I want to do these vertical joints as well, and I don't want to get any running water into these joints. Now, that is the one most important thing, is that everything has to be 100% dry. So if you have any water sitting anywhere around this tub surround, it's not going to bond. Water is your worst enemy when it comes to caulking. So you know, make sure that everything's 100% dry before you even attempt to try to do this. So now, this is a really, you know, doing an acrylic surround really makes this an easy system. This is much easier than doing caulking tile in a lot of ways, but it is important to make sure you fill these joints, because this is a little bit flexible. So, you know, you're going to have expansion and contraction when it gets warm and cold, and then the weight of everything, since it is acrylic, it is going to move. So these joints are really important to have filled well. So let's go ahead and do this back one here. So you can see how that's kind of buffering out a little bit. You know, that's quite a bit of silicone, but you want to make sure that joint is really well sealed. Caulk Ease. I have some paper towels, and we're going to use this caulking tool with the wider edge and see what this does. that barely gets into the joint. So we're gonna, you know, you can just test an area and see if you're squeezing and making any type of a nice joint. That's not really gonna get in there tight enough. So we're gonna do the smaller end here. I really didn't do a good job either because I kind of took everything out of the joint.
I was just going
to
say that.
So let's just try to do that again. Yeah, it's going to make a nice joint there.
You get a spray.
Yeah.
Is it like Windex?
Kinda, yeah.
Would you say better?
Top here too. This is just a okay, so that completes the tub surround. Now to go over some labor that I had in this project, you have to keep in mind that I had a lot of running around to do to try to find another tub surround that I actually can get behind. And really, this is pretty solid. I am actually pretty happy with it overall. Basically I had about 5 hours involved with demoing and installing the new tub. Okay, and then the next day it was installing the tub surround, which took about 4 hours. I did have a whole bunch of running around to try to find the tub surround, so you know, time is money, so you had to account for that. So make it 10 hours between taking out the old tub, putting in the new one, and then I had about 3 hours worth of painting and then caulking and everything being done. So just to let you know, I basically charged around $5,000. That's including all of the material. Now I did lose on that first tub surround, the way it goes sometimes. So that's why I'm making these videos, to prevent you from having the same problems and not having to put in something that's not gonna last or isn't gonna be good for you. So hope all these tips helped you out. Leave a comment down below if you have any additional tips that you might have encountered that would help out people. But I'll just keep making the content and bringing out more and more videos that are out here to help you plan, learn, build your own bathroom renovation.